Good evening, everyone. How are you all? Thank you for coming. Ramsey Awad is my name. Before we introduce our speaker, the School of Architecture and the Lockup acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Awabakal and Worimi peoples. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and continuing relationship with the land, and that they are the proud survivors of more than 200 years of disposition. We reiterate our commitment to address disadvantages and attain justice for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples of this community. It's a cold evening, so thank you. Everyone's rugged up. We've got a great speaker this evening. Before we start, though, we wanted to acknowledge our sponsors, in which we have a growing list of sponsors. We have Hunter Development Corporation. We have Hebel as a sponsor. We have Nagisa Japanese Restaurant as one of our sponsors. We had a new sponsor come online last week, which was Marline. The Lockup, of course. And finally, BKA Architecture. And they are our gold sponsor. And without all of their contributions, our series would be difficult to run. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight for a number of reasons. Allison Burrows not only works for BKD Architecture, who are our gold sponsor, but is an alumni of Newcastle University. Having graduated a number of years ago now, 2004, as one of our top students who actually went on to win the Board of Architects, the State Board of Architects Award for Best Graduate. So very accomplished, and having looked through Alison's career trajectory, it's impressive in terms of her travel and work overseas. And I wanted to tell this sort of great story about how Alison returned back to Newcastle to contribute to the community here and to the well-being of Newcastle, but just discovered in our little chat beforehand that even though Alison is based in Newcastle, she's actually never done a Newcastle project. So my mission now, Alison, over the next 12 months is try to find you a Newcastle project so you can start contributing to us here. Alison is going to tonight talk a little bit about BKD, the practice and sorts of projects that they're doing, and reflect on her career and take us through some of her key projects that she's done overseas and in other parts of Australia. And what I want us all to do is try to think of a question. Alison has said to me she's not going to talk for too long, so I'd like to use some of the time as a question answer session. So if all of you, and I may call on you randomly, just to put you on the spot like I do in my lectures, I might call on you randomly to ask a question. So while you're listening, think of an appropriate question. And also I'd like to welcome Alison's father, who's in the audience also, for a bit of moral support. So if you have any questions for him, feel free also to save them till the end. Guys, please make Alison feel very welcome. Thank you.
Hi. So I'm Alison, and I'm a director at Baker Cavanagh. And can you turn it down?
Yeah, just put it near your mouth.
That's okay. So I've worked for Baker Cavanagh since about 2004. So starting from a fifth year architect graduate to now. So I became a director at the end of last year. So still fairly new. And we've been sponsoring these kinds of events at the university for about the past 2 years. So it's getting a bit exciting for us. You might not even be aware of us. We've had an office presence here in the Hunter for about 17 years, but really never been a major office. And like Ramsey said, the tongue-in-cheek reasoning about what we've titled the talk tonight is that we've never actually done a job in Newcastle. Our office is around, will be classified as a medium-sized office, and we're around 30 to 35 level mark of staff. And this has been pretty intentional throughout our existence, finding that if we get any bigger, our senior staff start to lose touch with participation in projects. Senior staff involvement in every project is a big point of difference for us, between us and a lot of larger offices, and the philosophy behind why we've landed a lot of our larger jobs. Clients like to know that after a project's been awarded, you get what you're promised, and high-level service for high-level staff is important to us. So we propose to clients from the outset that a team of senior and junior staff and a mix of, like, to give a mix of experience and fresh ideas.
Allison, do you reckon you could just move the microphone a bit closer? Just the guys up the back can't hear a little. Thank you.
Good. Okay, our staff ratio is probably about 60 to 40 women to men. I don't know if this is unusual or usual. We like to think that we're a bit of a flexible firm with a high percentage of our staff having family flexible arrangements, and I know I certainly need one. Currently now we have three female directors and three male directors. The two old grey ones there on the left side are our sort of original founding fathers, and I can say that because neither of them are here. Our staff are divided over three offices in Sydney, Newcastle and Byron Bay, and we have six staff here in Newcastle and all mostly diligently sitting in the front row for me tonight. Our Newcastle staff work between the Sydney and Newcastle offices weekly, so we travel and work. There's 95% of our work's down there. BKA is definitely not one of those black suit wearing kind of offices, although we can certainly bring out one if we need one. We prefer to think of ourselves as approachable, sort of professional, flexible, but not too boring, hopefully. So I thought we would have a quick walk through some of the projects that we're doing at the moment. So our first job that we're doing that I'll show you is a job for Animal Logic Academy. And the construction of this was completed this month. It's a $4 million internal fit out for the UTS in Sydney. And Animal Logic are known best for animations such as Happy Feet and Lego Movies and Walking with Dinosaurs. The internal fit out is located on levels 3 and 4 of Building 15, which is the big square heritage listed one. And the fit out is purpose built for two new UTS courses presented in coordination with Animal Logic. The fit out is simple, open studio space populated by some heritage columns, which required for a seamless movement and flexibility of use. Everything, and I mean everything, in this fit out, furniture, partitions, lighting, within the space is movable, stackable, and it's the ultimate definition of flexible. The intention of the space is to be heavily enclosed and mundane, limited in colour and material expression, but ultimately supplied with futuristic AV technologies. And you could call it a cave, really, which is what it is, or as I'd like to think it, as a sacred space for the magical creation of digital creativity. The next job that we're working at the moment is at Taronga Zoo, which is the Taronga Institute of Learning and Science. This is a $24 million project currently being documented by one of our Sydney teams. And this project, unlike the last one, is about real animals rather than animated variety. It's a part of a 10-year capital development program to support the Taronga Institute. The project is divided into two sort of major hub components. A science hub, which houses staff and postgraduate students that participate in Taronga's scientific work program and life science operations, and a learning hub, which also houses staff and students that participate in learning programs at Taronga Zoo. So, another animal-based project, thank you Alex, is one for the University of Western Sydney, which is technically called UWS College Building. And this is a purpose-built teaching facility on the Bankstown campus. The building contains lecture theatres, seminar rooms and student common areas, and it's one of our first five-star Green Star rated buildings that we've had to do. It's primarily two blocks, which are offset by a junction, creating a central circulation space at its heart. We designed special ventilation systems for night flushing louvers and precast flooring systems to demonstrate the university's commitment to employing and executing good environmental principles. BKA also have a really long-standing relationship with a school in Randwick called the Emmanuel School. It's a strictly Jewish private school. Our latest project, completed late last year, was a new contemporary learning facility that included general teaching spaces, art studios, library, gymnasium, and a 200-seat theatre. The building itself inserts itself sensitively into the constructive site, respecting heritage surroundings and accommodating a really dramatic landscape. The building is primarily subterranean, and they've actually made it bomb-proof, which is specifically specified by our client, and also incorporates strong environmental design principles. Mm-hmm.
Why is it bomb-proof?
That's just what they've asked for. Which is funny, because now they don't even use the subterranean spaces. That's crazy. So another project we're currently preparing DAs for out west is for Georges River Council. And this is to redevelop an existing poorly utilised public space to be an exclusive recreational parkland. It's going to foster a whole range of active and passive recreational, sporting, community and social activities. The project is designing multi-purpose synthetic grounds for soccer, league and cricket, as well as a grandstand, change rooms, amenities, children's playground, barbecue, picnic shelters, etc., etc. It also has a youth facility, which is poorly provided for in the area, and it'll have associated offices and cafes. So this is another one that's also we're working on at the moment, but it's back in the inner city. And this is a DA for a $26 million hotel development on the corner of George and Valentine Street in Haymarket for a private developer. It's a bit of a tricky DA, so not all things that we do, you do the drawings and then the building gets submitted and it gets built. This is a political DA that we're doing. It's a proposal for a 163-room hotel development with commercial functions on ground floor and first floor. It's what we probably call a stage two DA for Sydney City Council, following a stage one submission that was rejected in Land and Environment Court. I probably wouldn't call it a dummy DA, but it's pretty close to it. But what it is a compliant submission to council's regulations that our client uses or wants to use as a bargaining tool to get their first submission re-looked at and potentially approved, but still get paid for it. The boarding house is a really popular hot typology with developers at the moment because they're taking advantage of DCP and LEP loopholes. This first one is in Kingswood, which Christy here is working on. It's a 39-room accommodation. It's across the road from University of New South Wales, and it's currently being constructed. This is one that's very early in sort of design development. It's in Newtown. We're probably calling it adaptive reuse at the moment. It's a bit of a unique one. It's a 55-room accommodation, and it's the adaptive reuse of a documented heritage church and school building, which goes back to 1890. So we're developing this in terms for a pre-DA rather than submitting it for a DA because it's a little bit sensitive. The last boarding house, which is a little bit more mundane, is a 32-room accommodation plus commercial functions, and it's on an amalgamated site in Sydney. So this last one is in King Street in Newtown. It's a small-scale infill development set within a multitude of heritage significant buildings, and it's currently in Council for DA assessment. It maintains a shopfront scenario, and the project comprises of ground-level retail with three levels of residential above and seven apartments in total with roof-level communal space. It's a little bit different project and interpretation of heritage appreciation, but the facade design apparently recognises and reflects treatment for acoustic and visual privacy from the main street, as well as providing quality indoor and outdoor space for residents. The screen is a sequence of vertical profiles that allude to the rhythms and proportions of the surrounding heritage features. So I guess we would hope that our projects are recognised for their ingenuity and contemporary aesthetic, functionality and response to brief requirements. Our major client base reflects that we have a strong commitment to delivering high level service and a collaborative culture and environment within our office that cultivates ambition to achieve design excellence. So I can stop spruiking about what our office does, and I can tell you really briefly about me. So I studied at both degrees at the University of Newcastle, and I had a few years off in between each degree to sort of recover, which most of you will understand, maybe. Thank you, Alex. My so-called recovery was firstly throwing myself in the deep end to sink or swim, moving to Japan to teach conversational English. The main point, I guess, for me was not to do anything related to architecture. But after a year, one gets homesick, and I decided it was time to screw my head back on and get some office experience and go back to uni. but I ended up working in a Sydney firm whose primary source of work was designing nursing homes, so it was really inspiring. Not. But I persevered and went back to uni and actually found that I enjoyed the course way more than before. And at the end of fifth year, I found myself an interview with BKA set up by the final year coordinator at the time, which was Mr. Graham Hewitt. And he was recommending me to give it a go as he'd mentored John Kavanagh, which was one of the original grey ones that you saw earlier, some years before, and thought our views and design and work ethic would align. So at that time, BKA did a few jobs up in the Hunter, and we worked in the back of a pub in Maitland. So I couldn't resist the $18,000 wage that they were offering at the time. It was better than sort of the cafe jobs. But not obvious, sort of 15 years later, BKA was a pretty good fit for me. Around 2006, we started to experiment with projects in the UAE and found ourselves pretty successful. And it wasn't long until the email was sent around testing the waters to see if any staff were interested to transition temporarily to an office based in Dubai to take it more seriously. And I think my response was pretty instantaneous. So the boyfriend and I parted ways. I sold the car and temporarily moved for an 8-week period that turned into 4 years. But the learning curve in that time was pretty vertical. And I won't lie, it was bloody hard work and a lot of it. But the other descriptive words that I'd use was, Alex, I hate you for this. Amazing, phenomenal, unique, life-changing, and I could go on, get the gist. So at the age of 27, I was working and traveling between Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Qatar, Egypt, and working on projects, like massive projects with massive budgets. We worked on some golf club houses, hotels, schools, universities, housing developments. So I had a few slides of each of those. But my baby, and 10 years later, I can't refrain from calling it my baby, was that kind of project. There's a project called Zone 6. It was an 800 apartment development spread between 5 towers. With ground level commercial functions. And we won this in a limited competition, and our promise to the client was that every apartment would receive a view. It was located in a sector of Dubai called Dubai Festival City, which is about 10 minutes from the airport if you've ever been there. So at 27, declared the project architect for this, I thought, oh, it was pretty unreal. I lived and breathed everything that this was about for 3 years, but at the end of 2010, we were all sitting at a bar having pre-Christmas drinks, and the dreaded phone call arrived that it was time to be shelved. And thus in 2017, it's still shelved, but I'm still hoping one day to get the phone call. So I promise 20 minutes. So to finally finish, my job is hard, stressful, frustrating, bloody frustrating, but at the same time rewarding. We work on great projects and we have a great team. And thanks.